Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
When are you going down?
John did.
Oh, we
have Spanish guy, you remember those days?
Boy, am I. I have the numbers. I've got good numbers.
Yeah,
that's good.
That was supposed to be fun.
It really is.
It's the CD.
I need to get a copy of that.
You have a copy?
From the people down here.
I can give it to you.
I'll get a copy.
My doctor, he's at the home now.
She will.
I can go home now, can't I?
He was a character, especially.
Voluntarily. Or, you know, not by choice.
Oh, did he?
I'm ready to roll.
I'm ready.
Ready for it.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we start the meeting, I'm going to call on Commissioner John Paisley to lead us in prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance.
And we can give everybody a balloon, too.
If I can have your attention, please. Thank you. Our Heavenly Father, we pray for all those that had damage, injuries, losses during the past several storms that we've had. And we pray that you help them get through their difficulties. We thank you for all the things that you have done for us and will do for us in the future. We pray that this board has wisdom and does what is best and right for Alamance County. We pray that you bless us all. All these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. Welcome to all of you. The first matter on the agenda is our public comments. And I'd like to call on Mr. Ed Hsu.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, one of our famous people here locally said recently there's a whole lot of lying going on. I don't doubt that. I'm sure that at least three of you will remember right in this room us and the sheriff discussing the stop where I wouldn't stop. And Ms. Massey was chairman then, and she said, well, they stopped me, so I'm sure you remember. Apparently, Sheldon Brown don't. If you will look at this testimony, you will see he don't recall nobody ever making a complaint about profiling. Now, I don't know what his intent was, but there is a CD at the 10 minutes, so I can't fit them in 3 minutes, but I made y'all a copy. If the copy is not good enough, I also provide you with a link on YouTube to the conversation, which has been there long enough for 178 people here. Now, I think it's time that y'all took action, and they got the county attorney, I don't know if putting the fox in the hen house, but somebody to investigate is our tax money funding criminal activity, because if this stands against that, you know, I don't know, I'm not a jury, but were I on a jury, I think that was one of those lies going on. Y'all could look and see, you can listen, or you can ignore it, it's up to you. But you are notified, and you know what's right there. So I'm going to try to get somebody to look at it, but whether I'll be successful or not, I don't know. But y'all should. Y'all have the power. You can say, say, Clyde, take this down to DA, see what you think. Tiffany, call the FBI in. What's going on here? Take care of the taxpayers. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cox?
Tony?
I tell you what, I agree with it. I seen that newspaper article talking about a lot of lying going on, and, you know, I agree with it. Boy, I've been a victim of it. I spoke out against it. It's amazing, but mine ain't hearsay. He said, she said. There's all kinds of recordings and documents and stuff like that. And, you know, we do need some investigations going on around here. Seems like whenever people stand up, I don't know. It's just so confusing to me. It's just like the people that come in here and offered that money, Peak Resources, and a rant went after them. That's the way it was described. I've heard it described that way. But, you know, we try to hire lawyers and so forth. I remember Tim, you probably remember this, Tim, standing in the parking lot at United Transmission, said that lawyers are thick as thieves, and they are. There's no doubt about it.
I said that.
Yeah. Over there at Craig Deaton's. You know, after the meeting, the last one, a couple of weeks ago, I was trying to get the information about the numbers of how many people was purged from the voter registration as a result of felony conviction last year. I can't get it. I've tried through Raleigh. People don't want to give it to me. Don't know why. But this little woman, she came to me at the end of the meeting. Boy, I could see some concern in her eyes. She looked at me. She said, "Can I help you, son?" I said, "Yes, ma'am." And she said that she wanted to pray. And we went across the street, and she listened to my story. She told me that she seen things going on in the back of the room, and she was concerned for my safety. She asked me not to come back down here no more. But I ain't going to stop coming. You know, I've been intimidated in this room. See, when Clyde and Jason, and y'all get personal all the time, when they charged Deborah Prince and brought her down here and denied Deborah Prince her rights and scared the ever-loving hell out of her, you should have seen it. There needs to be some investigations in here. I can't hire a lawyer. And I paid lawyers tens of thousands of dollars and hoped for the best. But, you know, I don't know. As a lawyer, there ain't no way that I would let people get treated the way we are treated here in the United States of America. In the county, well, let's look at Alamance County as a whole. I wonder how many people sit on these boards, councils, and commissions are lawyers. How many of the people that sit on these board, councils, and commissions in Alamance County are government employees? I wonder that. The door's always open.
Thank you, Tony.
Yes, sir.
Any response, commissioners?
Well, I will respond to his comment about what I supposedly said down at United Transmission. I remember the conversation. It was hot. We were both sweating, and we were both standing out front looking at each other square in the eye. And I told you basically that if I made a mistake when I voted the way I did with your situation, then I apologize, but I went on the evidence that I was given by people that are paid to give it to me. Okay, I don't remember ever mentioning a word about a lawyer. If I did, I wouldn't be ashamed to mention it.
I swear.
Well, that's my.
Wait a minute. We're not going to have any back and forth conversations, Tony.
He had his say, I had mine.
Thank you, Tim. The agenda, Mr. Manager, anything to add to or delete from the agenda?
If we remember, Board, that after this meeting, if we do not adjourn it, that we will kind of suspend the meeting, and then we have the training on the new agenda software right after this meeting. So, Mr. Chairman, if you don't officially adjourn the meeting, just take a recess, and then we'll come back.
All right.
How long is it?
30-40 minutes.
Sorry. I have a motion to approve the agenda, which will include the consent agenda.
So moved.
A second.
Second.
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mr. Williams, Mike?
Yes, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. My name's Mac Williams. I'm here as President of the Chamber of Commerce and in that role as the Economic Development Person for Alamance County. I am here this morning to ask you to set a date for a public hearing to consider incentives request for a company that's considering Alamance County for a location. As is required by this board for the process, I'm asked to disclose the company name in advance of the public hearing. I would ask that the date for the public hearing be for Monday, April the 7th, which would allow for the mandatory statutory 10-day period between setting the date and the actual public hearing that state law requires. That's why I'm here today, to ask you to set the date for Monday, April the 7th. The 21st. I don't know if I'd give you the company name now or after you set the public hearing. I don't know what the process is to do that, but the company name is Cambro Manufacturing Company, C-A-M-B-R-O. They're out of Huntington Beach, California. They are proposing a brand new construction facility in the industrial park there in Mebane. And we're going through all the process now of trying to do all the things that are necessary to make a deal happen. The incentives process at the county, also with the city of Mebane, the state, there are other things going on that are also now in process, and we're just starting that ball rolling. And this is the first step in that process.
Where are they from again?
Huntington Beach, California.
Good surfing area.
Yes, it is, actually. I'm sorry?
What is their product?
They do, they're a plastic injection molding company. They make things when you go and when you're in a restaurant or a place where there's food service going on, the plates, the glasses, the silverware, the food items themselves oftentimes are stacked and stored in these plastic crate-looking types of vessels, mm-hmm. and that they make those.
Mm-hmm. We've had something similar to that before, have we not?
Plastic injection molding, right. Yes. Right. I mean, we have several plastic injection molders in the county already, so right. it's internal to the building. There's not stuff going on outside the building. It's a very clean. We've been in their facility. We went and traveled out there not too long ago to see their facilities, to visit with them, to do all this. And they will be a very good corporate citizen in addition to the corporate roster should the deal occur here, we think.
Okay. Any other questions for Mike?
Is that a regular meeting date?
It is. That is our morning meeting.
Anything else, Mike?
That's it. Just requesting as you all's process requires, requesting the date.
Do I have a motion that we set a public hearing on April 7th?
Second.
Any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you very much. We'll be in touch.
Thank you, Mac.
Thank you, Mac.
Right. proclamation. Proclamation, Mr. Manager. Which proclamations do we have?
That's the one for the National Day of Service.
Do I have it? Oh, okay. Oh, right, where, right in front of me. Yeah, this the first proclamation is a recognition for National Day of Service, and if I could, I'll read this into the record. Whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges, and whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps address the most pressing challenges facing our cities, counties, and nation, and whereas national service expands economic opportunity by creating more sustainable, resilient communities and providing education, career skills, leadership abilities for those who serve, and whereas national service participants increase the impact of the organizations they serve with both through their direct service and by recruiting and managing millions of additional volunteers, and whereas national service represents a unique public-private partnership that strengthens community impact and increases the return on taxpayer dollars, and now therefore be it resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim April 1, 2014 as National Service Recognition Day and encourages residents to recognize the positive impact of national service in our county, to thank those who serve, and to find ways to give back to their communities. This 19th day of March, 2014.
I would be proud to make the motion to pass this resolution.
Second. Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Dave Leonard is going to give us an update on storm damage. David.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I appreciate the opportunity to come here this morning and speak on our condition of the county in regards to our winter weather storm that we had on 3-7. As you all know, that storm came in early that morning. We had a really early start here in the county. Our emergency agencies, beginning with our communication system, were inundated with calls for trees down, power lines down, and motor vehicle accidents throughout that entire day. And we had some record-breaking days for responses on all of our agencies. And that's countywide. That's even the municipalities, too, that were also responding to accidents. This ended up being a very large countywide storm event with quite a bit of power outages and trees down and things of that nature. That's created quite a bit of extra work now that we're continuing to do. At the height of the storm, we had roughly 65,000 citizens in Alamance County without, or 65,000 customers in Alamance County residents without power. The county is estimated at having roughly 75,000 customers, residents with electricity in our county. So we had all but 10,000 had lost their power in Alamance County. And a good portion of these residents had their power off for several days. Duke Energy, along with other partners, our electrical co-ops, were able to get our power pretty much restored by Tuesday following this event. So they worked very diligently bringing in extra crews into the county to do that. So again, a lot of work and a lot of effort was done and prepared. During this storm, it was quickly realized by your emergency management staff, and that includes all of our emergency agencies, that a shelter would need to be opened up for any residents that were possibly needing to seek shelter from not having any electricity. That shelter was opened at 10 o'clock on that Friday and remained open until Monday morning at 9 o'clock. During that time, it was staffed with our DSS, our health department, Graham Rec staff, as well as our local law enforcement from Graham and Alamance County Sheriff's Office supplying staffing for this event, in conjunction with our Red Cross and our Baptist Men too as well. So it was a great effort by everyone in that staff or everyone in those organizations to come together and work together. having been in the emergency management field here for almost 6 years with the county, I can tell you without a doubt, our shelter operations operate the smoothest of any that I've ever been able to witness going into other agencies and other counties to observe there. And we also get that feedback from the local Red Cross, too, as well, that our DSS and Health Department, in conjunction with all the other agencies that support them, run a very smooth and great operation. They're completely staffed. They're attentive to the individuals that are there. So it's worked out very well with us having that relationship that they have with each other. Where are we at now? Well, again, we have a large amount of debris. Our DOT is now asking for contracts to be awarded to individual private folks to come out and start removing our debris. They hope to have these contracts in place by the end of this week so they can start their debris removal process. They will be removing all the debris from the state-maintained roads. So throughout our county, we look to get this going pretty quickly. Also, our local municipalities, as well as some of the county agencies that were involved in the expenses that were incurred, we have FEMA on site right now doing damage assessments and working with our local municipalities to get a preliminary number up. In order to have a federal declaration, there has to be about $13 million in damages. Right now, FEMA is estimating, based on all the states that will be looking into this, and there's approximately 14 counties, we're right around $20 to $25 million right now of what they're estimating in the damages from the storm. So it looks like we will, in fact, exceed the federal threshold of $13 million. Alamance County's portion of that little threshold there has to exceed a little over $500,000. We have already exceeded that with just the electrical co-ops, what they have turned in, as well as the debris cleanup from some of our municipalities. So we do qualify for that. So what FEMA is on site now doing with the state is they're preparing all this documentation to give to our governor, who will then, in fact, turn around and take it to the president, and hopefully we can get a federal declaration declared for our immediate area here. The time frame of that, well, we're not really sure, but we're going to push it as hard as we can to speed it up for that federal declaration. In the meantime, a lot of our municipalities have contracts in place or securing a contract to do their debris removal cleanup. All this has to be monitored. Every number has to be crunched to make sure that we're following it, you know, to the letter of the law. So when FEMA comes in and looks at our records, we have that true documentation. One of the things that we're working with is our landfill. Our old landfill at Swepsonville has an approved site, a Diener approved site, that will allow us to move debris in. And I also got to give a plug to our landfill. In 2002, apparently we had a significant event, a weather-related event, much like what we had now. They were able to go back, pull all of their records and documentation, and have that in place, a plan in place that we could utilize this time. And I'll ask Greg if he wants to add anything to that, but that's what we're looking at now in partnership with DOT.
Thank you so much, Dave. Good morning, Commissioners. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to echo a little bit about what he said. The magnitude of this storm and the volume of material has necessitated our petitioning NC Diener to open our Swepsonville site, and we wanted to make this board aware of that. This will be specifically for DOT material. Our normal customers will continue to come into the Austin Quarter landfill. We had a concern about 150 loads of debris per day and the safety. If we add that to our current 100-150 trucks coming into our Austin Quarter landfill, so we felt it essential that we open the Swepsonville facility to accommodate that volume. It will be just specifically for DOT material. That pretty much just firms that up.
Some of the estimated amounts of debris that DOT is looking at is anywhere from 100,000 cubic yards to 150,000 cubic yards. And our site at Swepsonville will more than adequately handle that. At this time, I'll entertain any questions you may have. Again, I probably would like to come back before you again to keep you involved in the process, especially when the declarations take place. I think the operation worked very smoothly. We have a lot of great emergency services folks out there. A lot of community folks have stepped up too as well. I can't say enough great things about your citizens here in Alamance County. They've been very patient with us, worked well with us, and we do appreciate that, as well as every municipality working closely together in this event.
150 loads per day, approximately how many days do we think we're talking about?
Commissioner Payson, we're looking at, had a meeting with DOT and engineers last Friday. They've placed the date of 1st of June for completion of this project. Now that is a, they hope to wind it up in May, but certainly it will be a couple of months. I think the initial shock in all of this storm, that part is kind of coming to an end, but the cleanup process is going to be much more in depth. And I will have staff at the Swepsonville landfill to oversee the cubic yards coming in, because we will have to bill DOT for those cubic yards, because we're going to ultimately have to grind this material. It'll be a challenge on our landfill staff to try to maintain two different sites, but we stand ready to meet that need.
Mr. Chairman, if I could say, I do want to thank the work that Dave has done and all of emergency services throughout this event, even through our event on Monday. Very much on top, very much in communication with our partners, very much in communication with the state, and again, all the work that DSS and the Health Department did as well at our emergency shelter. One thing we do want to mention, that probably the biggest impact now for the county moving forward is the Swepsonville site and opening up that. One of the things we're going to have to do is hire additional staff, temporary. It's not going to be full-time. But the thought process is, once we do that and we can monitor what is being brought in, we will charge the DOT back for what they bring us. And we also feel that any additional costs will be picked up once the declaration is made. So we just wanted to make you aware, if you started seeing, you know, expenditures going out, that is one of the reasons why. But we do feel like that the declaration will be made and we will get that reimbursed.
Mr. Commissioner, I would also like to thank these two gentlemen in particular. They both stayed in touch with me, kept me up to date. Mr. Leonard particularly helped me on a power line that was about 3 feet off the ground. I felt like it was going to injure somebody. So, and that has been corrected, by the way, thanks to your efforts. Thank you, gentlemen.
How did our alternative power sources for county buildings and county functions and the shelters, how did they perform?
I think Richard Hill's here. To our knowledge, they worked very well this time.
Perfectly. We had no failures on generators or throw switches, and we pumped about $20,000 worth of diesel oil over the course of this 5 days.
Is that for the shelters as well?
The shelters were handled by an independent group. They, I think, contracted generators in.
Graham Rec never lost power, which was kind of amazing. But that was one reason why they had said Graham Rec was a very good choice for shelter, because of the Duke Energy structure in place. So it never did. Our shelter at Lamb's Chapel ran for just a short period of time. Then we took down that shelter site. So.
But as the board's aware, we lost power at this building, and CECOM ran on backup generator power for 3 days?
No, we lost power here about 7 in the morning, and this is one of the first buildings back up late that afternoon. The other critical was the jail.
Right.
It went down at 7 o'clock Friday that was, morning, yeah. And ran to about 10 o'clock on the next Tuesday.
That's right.
And we went down to Justice Emergency Management Office. It ran until Saturday afternoon.
Right.
Anything else, Jen? Linda didn't lose power. I'm close to a transformer over there. I think that's what happened. The substation is close to my house. So.
Thank you, David.
Thank you,
Greg.
I was happy.
Richard.
I didn't lose power.
You know, Duke Power has been getting a bad rap lately because of some things they did or didn't do, but I think they did an excellent job in getting the county back together, and we need to let them know that we think that they did. Anything else on storm, guys? Mine was out for 3.5 days, by the way.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Next, we have our department spotlight. It's Veterans Services today. Brenda?
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I am Brenda Perry with Veteran Services. I have been with Veteran Services for 23-plus years, so I'm very proud to say that. This morning, before I began, I wanted to introduce you to my coworker, since I am a two-person office. I felt it important that you put a face with a name. This is Tammy Crawford. Tammy came to work with me February of 2012, and she is doing an awesome job. Veterans really do like her. I'm going to be very brief this morning, since I've been moved back and forth with this for many times now. I never know when I'm going to be here. As I said, our office operates on a two-person staff. Our current operating budget right now is a little over $10,000. The veteran population for Alamance County is currently at 11,450 veterans, and we still rank 14th in the state in veteran population. Our office averages assisting veterans or their dependents each month, approximately 300 per month between the two of us. And out of those 300, our office served a total of 3,566 clients for 2013, just for two of us. VA paid out over $53 million in benefits to our veterans and their dependents for Alamance County last year. Our primary job is to file claims for service-connected compensation, non-service-connected pension, and medical enrollment. We also assist with burial benefits, obtaining copies of military records. We run into this all the time. Veterans who, especially our Vietnam veterans, Korean veterans, have lost their 214s, misplaced them somewhere, or mad ex-wives have burned them up. So we're forever applying for those copies as well. We do assist with insurance, burial benefits, as I said, and we also assist other agencies such as hospice, funeral directors, veteran service organizations, and other agencies such as we assist Alamance Elder Care, Carnotal Senior Center, and Piedmont Senior Health Center. Just to brag on ourselves a little bit, Tammy and I are both members of the North Carolina Association of County Veteran Service Officers. We attend two training conferences per year, one in the spring, one in the fall, and we have to do that to maintain our accreditation in order to file claims for the veterans. I'm also a member of the National Association of County Veteran Service Officers. Tammy will be studying for that accreditation next week, which is not mandatory. She will be able to file claims through different agencies at that time. We attend training meetings quarterly held by the North Carolina Division of Veterans Affairs. We have to do that in order to keep our accreditation through the state to be able to file the claims for veterans. We're often called on a lot of times to make in-home visits, nursing home visits, when the veteran or the dependent cannot come to our office. So we make a field visit, as we call that, take the claim there, bring it back to the office, and forward that on to the VA. We're both on the planning board for the Triad Homeless Veteran Stand Down. That is held in September of each year in Greensboro. We usually average about 300 homeless veterans. We assist them with showers, two hot meals that day, all kinds of benefits such as Social Security. There are benefits counselors there, and just an array of additional information that we assist them with that day. That is just a really special event. The DOD brings in clothing, truckloads of clothing. It's a two-day event for us most of the time because of the setup and then the day of the event. So we enjoy doing that very much. My office also has a veteran service board. This board is established in 1945 primarily to secure support for the veteran service office. We do meet on an annual basis, and I currently have five members on that board. I don't really have much else to tell you this morning about veteran services except one thing. I was kind of saving this and hoping that I could present this to you before it got out to the media. But with the support of Craig and Brian and Mayor Jerry Peterman, our office will be sponsoring and hosting Alamance County's first ever Veterans Day Parade. On Veterans Day, it will be held in downtown Graham on that Tuesday. The 11th of September, we will begin that parade at 1 o'clock downtown Graham. The parade route will be pretty much like the Graham Christmas Parade. I have several people who have already expressed interest in it. The high school bands are starting to express interest in this. This has been a long time dream of mine to come true, and I'm very, very pleased that is going to happen for us. I really don't have anything else for you this morning. If you have any questions, please ask, or feel free to stop by our office. Please come by and see the flag that's hanging up in our office. It was in the newspaper. The Eastern High School students did an amazing job with that. And that will hang there for as long as it will stay. It's very brittle with the paint, but hopefully, thanks to Richard and Buddy, they got that up for us on our wall. Covers almost a complete wall in our office building. Any questions?
Any questions on the wall? Brenda, the homeless veterans, do you keep up with them on a regular basis?
Through Alamance County, we are not given any statistics on that for each county through the state. So I do not have that information. I do know there are a few. We're approached by some homeless veterans. In fact, we had one a year and a half ago who was living out in the woods and came to us, and we got some benefits started for him. The ones who are homeless are usually in the shelter on Fisher Street, but then they're moved to other places. I had one who I had worked with for several years who lived at the shelter. He called me last week, told me that because of what we did in our office for him, he was able to relocate to Salisbury. He actually got a job within the VA Medical Center, and that was great news to hear that. That gentleman worked very hard to get where he was at, so I was very pleased to hear that. But as far as the statistics for that, no, sir, we are not provided that through the state.
Okay, anything else from the board?
I'd like to ask, it just popped in my mind, do you know if the names we have on our wall here, Vietnam vets, are the match up numerically with the names on the wall down in Davidson County?
As far as I know, they are. They are supposed to be. And I've never heard that they were not. Right. So as far as I know, they are. Yes, sir.
How do you get a list of the names on the wall down in Davidson?
In Davidson County, that would be probably easy to do through our contact, service officer in the Davidson County office.
Can you do that?
Would sure,
you
check on I'll it? Be happy to yeah. do that.
Y'all ever been down there to see that wall?
It's an amazing
Vietnam wall.
Yeah, Vietnam. And mm-hmm. What's crazy about it is the interstate crosses over,
mm-hmm.
and when you come out of there, you get lost.
You can easily get lost and end up yeah. going in the wrong direction.
Yeah, you wind
there.
Up going to Charlotte, but I take That's kids right. down there occasionally, and it's like it's out in the middle of nowhere, and the peace and quiet. To walk up and see Alamance. I think the bricks have each county listed mm-hmm. as far as the name of the county, and then you just have to know the name.
Absolutely, but I will get the information
if you would,
for you,
I appreciate
Mr. Sutton.
It.
I certainly will do that. Anything
Thank you,
else?
Brenda.
Thank
Thanks
you.
Very much. Thanks. County Attorney.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You have in your packet a property valuation analysis of the proposal that was made by Peak Industries at our last meeting. I've contacted them and told them the board was desiring a cash offer, and they are agreeable to negotiating a cash offer. One of the things we need to look at is the value of the beds. We've got a consulting firm that has put together a proposal that can give us a certified evaluation of the value of the beds. We have a $20,000 value. We believe it might be more than that. And this proposal from Ascendant was put together through working with Susan Osborne. They have come up with a proposal for about $13,000. They will look and evaluate and value the beds for us. And we're hearing numbers that are above $20,000. So as part of the negotiation, we'll need to nail down that figure. If you look further on the valuation, we've got the land value of the North Main Street property. With the beds that we have there, $2.9 million. Of course, it may be more. The bed valuation's higher. and then the county would retain after the sale 7 acres on Woody Drive at $300,000 an acre, and that was obtained through a real estate appraisal that Mr. Manning got for us, a valuation, not an appraisal. And then we have the capital received from the billboard lease of $180,000. So
is that per year? That income per year?
Per year is $9,000 per year for the, actually it's $8,000 now, but I think in 2 years it goes up to $9,000. That's with the signed copy. So
the billboard you're talking about?
The billboard, yes. We lease that. So if that is the board's wish, I will contact Peak and negotiate an offer to bring back to the board. That offer, if the board approves that offer, it will be advertised for 10 days. There's a 10-day upset period. If no one upsets it, then it comes back to the board for final approval of the offer.
Any question?
I have one. The $13,000
yes.
to value those bids.
Yes.
Can that be done without spending that money? Is there a state agency, federal agency, somewhere we can get that data without spending that money?
Well, these people, this is their business. They do this kind of thing. We're talking about $2.4 million at $20,000. Mm-hmm. If those beds are actually valued at $40,000, that'd be another $2.4 million. I would recommend that the board spend that $13,000 to get a proper evaluation.
And it's caused, we have checked around with different health agencies, and again, the range is just so varied. We're uncomfortable about coming back to you and saying this is the right price. And we do realize that there is the cost associated with it, but for something that's permanent, that's the reason why we were looking at getting somebody in to give us a valid figure.
Thank you. That's the answer I was looking for.
Yes, sir. We don't want to give them away.
Right. I asked for this. Can you give us an academic definition that a layperson can understand of the definition of the value of a bed, please?
What a willing buyer on the market would be willing to pay for a bed.
Can you get a little more simple with that, please?
If you have, we have 120 beds for sale.
Right. Now you're saying a license for that bed, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And it's a little more complex than that because they base the valuation on the building that is being used and the service that's been provided by the company. So, and their location. So it's a pretty complex analysis that these folks.
Well, does the state offer a definition? I mean, they're the ones that give the licensing for the bed, right?
What they do, they calculate need based on the population of the county. I don't think the state gives a puts a value on, but that's something these folks, they're experts in this business.
Oh, I'm not knocking it. I just wanted to be able to discuss it intelligently. I mean, I just hadn't given. I asked for that.
Yep. And again, it is so varied. You get so many different opinions about bed valuation, and the state will just say you have a bed need, and you'll allocate it based upon the need, but they really don't put the valuation to it. It really is, you know, we something this major, we didn't want it to be a crapshoot for you.
With this offer that we have now and or the negotiations, is it possible to put this deal together without selling the beds? Does it have to be a component of this transaction?
The proposal that's been made by Peak is based on purchasing the beds, and then they would build a new building in this area.
I understand that.
That, of course, negotiation, anything's possible in negotiation. If that's something the board wants us to look at, we can certainly look at that.
I think we need to look at that.
And again, one of the things in class discussion when we said, hey, what about this? I said, oh, yeah, we can make that work. Well, that means probably telling us we were looking at a low valuation on that. So, again, that's why we wanted to make sure we were getting as fair valuation on the beds as we could.
I think of it as a piece of artwork. What's the Rembrandt worth?
That's right.
I don't know. I know it's worth a lot of money, but I don't know just how much.
Where do we get the revaluation, the valuation of the property on Main Street?
From, what's the realtor's name?
Richard Jones. He's a commercial realtor.
Richard Jones.
That seems awful cheap to me.
What is it?
$26,000 for an acre. That land is ready to build on. You don't have to do a thing but start building. That's awful cheap.
Well, he's the go-to man in Alamance County, but we can certainly take another look at that as well if you want to.
I was thinking the tax value on that, whenever it was bought, was around $900,000.
Yeah. Remember, when it was purchased, it had a structure on it.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, I guess you're asking...
I'm asking for some direction on how you wish to proceed. If you want me to go ahead and enter negotiations along the lines that we've discussed, we can start that and come back to you with an offer.
Well, I for one think $13,000 invested, hopefully, or maybe to get another million or 2 million is certainly worthwhile. Any other?
I certainly agree with that comment. Absolutely.
Do I have a motion that we do proceed with the evaluation with this company?
Ascendiant.
Ascendiant.
It's a 13. Their proposal was $13,500.
And that Clyde be given the authority to commence negotiations subject to the valuation of those bids.
I would so move.
Any a second?
Second.
All any other discussion on this issue? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Mr. Allwright, we appreciate your taking this in hand.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Clyde.
Thank you.
Health Department budget amendment.
Good morning, Mr.
Chairman. Good
morning. Commissioners.
Good morning.
So this morning I'm presenting a request for a budget amendment in the amount of $2,000. The Health Department has received a letter of allocation of $2,000 from the Gestational Diabetes Collaborative. And the collaborative is made up of the Chronic Disease Section, the Women and Children Section, and the North Carolina State Center of Health Statistics under DPH at the state level. These funds will support local efforts to screen and identify women who are postpartum, who had a history of gestational diabetes, who may then be at risk for the chronic type 2 diabetes. Women with a history of gestational diabetes are at higher risk for developing type 2 diabetes, which is why it's so important to screen. So specifically, the funds will be used to reimburse the lab time and the materials for performing the actual screening.
Any questions? Motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, sir.
Finance officer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have completed the initial budget meetings. The committee has met with every department head within the county. I appreciate the work of the committee on that. That committee is consisting of Chairman Smith, Commissioner Sutton, Craig Honeycutt, Susan Roberts, and myself. Our next step in that process is to hear the request from the principal outside agencies that we fund. That's next Tuesday in this room at 10 o'clock. One thing I do want to mention is a couple of times during our budget meetings, the subject of the performance-based pricing and its implications on this year's budget was brought up. Brian and I talked a little bit after the last series of meetings, and Brian is in a position to give a brief thoughts on that process.
Yes, sir. We're looking at the audited savings from each department. We started our performance management, performance-based budgeting policy for the 12-13 fiscal year. We have all the department's reports. Every department participated. I have copies of their results. We're now looking at the audited savings that we've been given the numbers from finance, and we'll look at what each department saved. We've hit the first threshold with the performance management policy, which was once fund balance hit 12%, departments could retain 75% of their savings. There were some other benchmarks that can't go over 8% of their budget, and then their goals come into play. They start losing their ability to retain all of their savings if they didn't make all of their goals. So that's what I'm doing right now, looking at the department's goals, looking at the audited savings, and I'll be able to get back with the county manager and the finance officer with those figures very soon.
Now, will that be itemized sheet, program sheet or whatever?
Yes, yes. We'll have a report. I've pretty much got it put together except for the dollars that I'll be able to present to management and to you. They'll let you know how the departments fared, how their goals went, and then their savings based on the existing policy.
Let me ask you a question about we've had a couple of department people come in and say that performance-based budgeting definitely worked, definitely helped them, and they are looking to see some money possibly be able to be channeled back through, of course, some things they want. But setting of the goals, at what point of the fiscal year do we, or fiscal, do we set the goals?
Usually we do that toward the end of the fiscal year. Departments participated again this year. So it was usually, I think it was in June of last year, we started asking departments, give county management your goals. Most of them stayed with something similar to what they did in 12-13, because they have a data and some benchmarks. We had some departments that changed goals. They realized some of them weren't easily tracked. 12-13 was kind of an opportunity for most departments to learn about setting goals and how to measure them. So, we'll be doing the same thing this year, getting back to the department.
Was this the first year of full implementation?
2012-2013 was, yes.
Right. Okay, so second year.
Right? Yes, we're in the second year now.
What percentage of departments are involved now?
Start of the year, we had all on board again. Reporting, departments report differently. I think we have about half the departments that report every month. Some report quarterly, some report at the halfway mark. But everyone's participating. If you remember this program, everyone participated even if they didn't set goals. They may be only participating on a savings basis. The difference was if the department did not set goals, their savings are accrued at a much reduced rate. So you may have a department that says they're not going to participate. They're still in. They just won't be able to retain any savings at the same rate as a department that that does set goals. And it also had some bearing, I think, on some of the things they could do with their money, too.
Was management at all in this past fiscal year involved with influencing the goal, the setting of the goal, or is it just left up to the department head to set the goal?
We work with the departments to try to help them set goals that could be, you know, specific, measurable. That's really the toughest part of this, I think, is for a department to set a goal that they can actually show a result. Yeah. And both county manager's office and finance work with department heads. Some folks grasp that pretty well. Some folks had to think about it a little bit and think of their department. When you start talking about some of our departments from an efficiency standpoint and a customer service standpoint, that's what most of these goals revolve around. Both finance office and county manager's office work with the departments to help them cipher that out.
Yeah, I was just right, you know, we were involved in getting this going, you know, when we went down to Davidson County and saw what they were doing. They were nationally recognized for what they did. And I believe that, you know, county management needs to be involved in setting a goal. And, I mean, the trend is in business that way, even in the military. I mean, I remember when Norman Schwarzkopf said he could not do what they wanted him to do. And White House said, you will or we'll replace you. And he got it done. And I still believe that management has to be somewhat influential in at least negotiating a goal
right
with a department head.
Right.
And not just leave it up to them.
Right. And we are. And again, as Brian stated, where performance management has come really full circle is we've met the minimum requirements for fund balance. You know, we were starting to say, you know, it was not that big a deal. It was a big deal. But until we reached the level of 12% and above on fund balance, that's when the departments were supposed to start seeing some of the benefits from that. And now that we are there in much quicker than we expected, that's where we're now going back and readjusting
what they can keep and what they can't keep and what they're planning to do with those savings, and hopefully looking towards next year's budget as well. But again, I do appreciate the work that Brian and Susan and Tom are doing on this.
I think I've had some questions from different department heads and so forth asking, is this going to be honored? Is that agreement of this previous board? I was not on the board when it happened, but I think it was a good move. Can we just reassure those department heads and therefore the employees that this is going to happen?
Well, I think one thing.
And I'm saying I can't speak for the other board members.
One thing that will help, we've since 12-13 was the first year of full implementation. Once we look at the dollar amounts that departments will be able to retain, I think that will help us all right. decide, are we going to honor that? I can't tell you right now how much that is. You know, I know the county reverted funding to fund balance after 12-13. Some of that was departmental savings. So once I get through looking at the benchmarks set in the policy, I'll be able to tell you and management how many dollars does that mean would have to be earmarked for departments. If everyone's comfortable with that, you know, that would be, to me, the time you can tell departments, okay, we've realized what your savings are, we know what our financial health is, we're comfortable with that, this is your banked amount of dollars.
And until we met those benchmarks on fund balance, the departments knew that they were not getting any of the savings. So the good thing is we've met the benchmarks on our fund balance quicker than we expected. And so that's now why we're going back now and looking at the savings. And again, we will bring that spreadsheet back to you and say, here are the potential savings. And again, that will have to be done as part of the budget process as well. As part of the, you know, if we take any money that was saved and then we allocate that from prior years, that will be a budget decision during the budgeting process.
I guess my concern is, for hypothetically, and I'm saying I'm just pulling numbers out of the mm-hmm. air, but if a department saved $200,000 and they did that through sacrificing, maybe by doing two jobs instead of one, for example, in a department, they didn't make a replacement. There are all kinds of ways that they save that hypothetical $200,000. They personally made those sacrifices. I think they need to be reassured that, hey, you saved the county, hypothetically, $200,000, and part of that's going to come back to our department for X, Y, Z, or for whatever the need is.
Right. That's the incentive.
Right.
I agree. Right.
And that's what we'll be able to tell you,
right.
the total amount that would need to be earmarked for all the departments, plus what would need to be earmarked for each department. And then once they, if that's what we go forward with, which I hope we will, if that happens, then the departments, once they start their plan to how to spend their savings, because there are only certain things they can spend their savings on, those items come back to the board too. So that would come to you to say, you know, if recreation saved money and recreation wants to buy a new piece of equipment, that'll be submitted to you for review. So recreation wants to use some of their savings to buy some piece of equipment. You would need to approve that. So any of those expenditures, right. you do have the opportunity to review them and, right. and approve them too. But hopefully, yes, I think it will it'll validate the program, right. if they're able to actually retain their savings.
And what that would occur is if the next budget cycle, which is now, those savings that were allocated to the department would be reflected in increased allocation for that particular department.
Yeah. Fellow commissioners, I would encourage us to just reassure those department heads and therefore all the employees that we're looking at this carefully and it's going to happen.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Anything else, Tom?
Yes, sir. That's all.
County manager?
Just want to, again, a lot of thanks to the budget committee and also for Commissioner Paisley has attended the meetings as well. And thanks to Tom and to Susan for the work that they've done organizing. I think it has really gone well. Our department heads have been very appreciative of the process and the opportunity to give their wants and their needs as well and kind of update of what they see as far as moving toward the future. But again, do appreciate the work that has been done by the committee, but also finance as well and our department heads. And again, just to reiterate for the ice storm, special thanks to CCOM, special thanks to Sheriff's Department, special thanks to everybody. This has been a crazy winter. Icemageddon was just incredible. But again, everybody from health department, social service, everybody really did pull together, and we're doing after action plans now to see what went well, what we need to improve on. So it's been a great learning process, and we really do appreciate everybody who was a part of that. The other thing I did want to mention to you is that tonight, please don't forget the city-county meeting at Elon Community Church, dinner at 6 p.m. With the county and the municipality. So that will be tonight at 6 at Elon Community Church. And that's all I have.
Any other comments by commissioners? Mr. Manager, I don't understand why we don't adjourn and then get back together for the program.
It's a continuation of the meeting. The training part will be a continuation of the meeting.
Is that required?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
That it be part of a meeting?
Well, you have five commissioners here.
Right.
Thought it'd be cleaner just to go ahead and
have
the training. It's not going to take that long, then we can adjourn.
Right.
If folks that want to sit and watch it, they can watch it too.
Well, I think it'd be better to adjourn.
I agree with you.
I hear a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye. Bureaucracy.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.